blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon him. One final breath he gave as heaven looked away, the sun.
Please stand for our gospel litany. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning. His clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him, they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women,
"Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he is risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you."
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. And when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said,
"All authority in heaven and on earth has been given
to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, to the very end of the age."
Christ is risen.
He is risen, indeed.
They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. But Jesus said to them,
"Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have."
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them,
"Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it."
A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said,
"Peace be with you."
And then he said to Thomas,
"Put your fingers here, see my hands. Reach out your hands and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe."
And Thomas said to him,
my Lord and my God.
Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Let us join in singing our processional hymn, Jesus Christ is risen today. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, you gave your only Son to suffer death on the cross for our redemption. And by his glorious resurrection, you delivered us from the power of death. Make us die every day to sin, that we may live with him forever in the joy of the resurrection. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
Our first reading is from Isaiah chapter 25, verses 6 through 9. More than 700 years before Christ, the prophet Isaiah proclaims the good news of God's salvation and calls all people to rejoice. God will make a rich feast for all people. God will wipe the tears from their eyes. And most importantly, God will destroy death itself. On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, a rich food filled with marrow, a well-aged wine strained clear. And he will destroy on this mountain the shroud that is cast over all peoples, the sheet that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. Then the Lord God will wipe away the tears from all faces, and the disgrace of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him, so that he might save us. This is the Lord for whom we have waited. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Word of God, word of life. Our second reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 11. The core of the Christian faith and Paul's preaching is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. As the crucified and risen Christ appeared to the earliest of his followers, so we experience the presence of the risen one in the preaching of this faith. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is within me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, and so you have come to believe. Word of God, word of life.
I'd like to invite the children forward at this time for a children's message, a special children's message. Come on up, kids. Don't be shy. Have some things to share with you today. It's an exciting day, isn't it? Yes, and some of you dressed up wonderfully, beautifully. Oh, look at that, sparkles and all. Great, come on up, you guys. Have a seat right up here with me if you want. Thank you, got more coming. Bring them on. That's awesome, we're excited to see you. Are you excited for today? Is there something special going on today? Anybody know?
Easter.
Cool, I love Easter. How many of you like Easter? Raise your hand. Yeah? What's fun about Easter? What kind of things do you do at Easter that's fun and that you like? Yeah?
I can pray to God.
You can pray to God. That's the best one I've heard yet. Yes, you can because of what Jesus has done. What else? Are there some fun activities maybe? I think you maybe saw something when you came in from outside. Easter egg hunt? How many of you saw the eggs? Yeah, do you know what you're going to do after the service today?
Easter egg hunt.
Easter egg hunt. Yeah, you're going to find some eggs. In fact, you're going to meet right in the back of the church, just on the outside. There's a bench there. Somebody's going to meet you there, and you're going to have bags that you probably already have the bag, don't you? Yeah, and they're going to have a planned Easter egg hunt. So that's something special. Anything else special about Easter? He has risen. What does that mean? I wonder. He is risen. Who rose?
God.
Yeah. Jesus rose from the dead. It was sad on Friday. We remembered Good Friday when Jesus died. And today we remember on the third day he rose from the dead so we too might live and have new life. So even though we see some sad things in the world, we see death, maybe one day we ourselves will experience death. We know that Jesus died and rose from the dead, so we put our faith in him. We believe in him. He promises to raise us up and to welcome him into heaven forever. Is that a good thing?
Yes.
Yes. So we celebrate that, and the Easter egg hunt is kind of a little bit like that. Reminds us when you open up the egg, the surprise to see that Jesus is alive. We see sometimes surprises or treats in those. That's part of that, too. And in those treats, sometimes, like, what kind of things you might find? Let's say candy, right? Or toys, yes. Well, someone thought it would be fun for me to hand out something special to all of you, a treat, to remind you of Easter. So I'm going to have you each grab one. And in there is a book marker. There's one for everybody. Yeah. And there's a sucker, right? What's the candy in the shape of?
A cross.
A cross, yes. And what, can anybody see what it says on the cross? What's the word there? He lives. That's the resurrection. He is alive. What, you're welcome. She said, thank you. And I didn't even get these. Somebody else got them for me to give you. So we have this wonderful reminder. And what is it? Does it taste sour, do you think?
No.
Does it taste yucky?
No.
What does it taste like?
Sweet.
Sweet. And that's why at Easter, the sweetness of the hope we have in Jesus is that he is alive. And it tastes sweet just like these treats are. The message that we have to share today. So today is a day of celebration, right? Are you ready to celebrate?
Yeah.
Yes. Well, let's have a prayer because we can pray. Put your hands together and repeat after me. Dear God,
thank you
for rising from the dead.
Help us
celebrate this day,
the promise of the
resurrection. And give us joy in knowing you and raising us up to new life today and every day. Amen. All right, you guys can go back down and sit and find your family. Great. Thank you for coming. Look forward to hopefully seeing you next week as well. We'll give you a minute for them to find their spots there. Wonderful. As you are able, I invite you to please stand for our gospel acclamation.
Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father, and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. There were three fools who tragically died, and they were met at the pearly gates by St. Peter, the gates of heaven. St. Peter told them that they could enter the gates of heaven if they could answer one simple question. All three agreed. So St. Peter said to the first one, the first question, he said, "What is Easter?" "Oh," the first fool replied, "that's easy. It's a holiday in November when everyone gets together, eats turkey, and is thankful." Wrong, said St. Peter. "That's Thanksgiving." So St. Peter turned to the second fool and asked the same question, "What is Easter?" The second fool responded, "Well, Easter's that holiday in December when we put up a nice tree, exchange presents, and celebrate the birth of Jesus."
No.
St. Peter looked at the second fool, shook his head in disgust, and told her she was wrong. "That's Christmas." St. Peter then turned to the third fool and asked him, "What is Easter?" The third fool smiled confidently and looked St. Peter squarely in the eyes and said, "I know what Easter is." "Oh," said St. Peter incredulously, "Easter is a Christian holiday that coincides with the Jewish celebration of Passover. Jesus and his disciples were eating at the Last Supper. Jesus later was betrayed and then turned over to the Romans by one of his disciples. But the Romans took him and crucified him. He was stabbed in the side. He was made to wear a crown of thorns and hung on the cross with nails in his hands and his feet. He was buried in a nearby cave, which was sealed off by a large boulder." St. Peter smiled broadly. He was very happy with that answer. But the man continued, "And every year the boulder is moved aside so that Jesus can come out. And if he sees his shadow, there will be 6 more weeks of winter." Now that's a lot funnier where I come from, because 6 more weeks of winter means another foot of snow, right? A big deal. But maybe the bigger question is, what is Easter? What is Easter? Since we have a bunch of kids here today, and all of you were kids at one time, perhaps you remember playing a game, freeze tag. You ever play that game? Is that fun? How does it work? I think somebody's usually it, right? And then everybody runs around, and if the person who's it touches you, you have to freeze in place and you can't move. You're frozen, right? Unless one of those other ones comes over and touches you and sets you free again. But there's that moment you're frozen. And of course, the one who's it, if they can catch all the people, the last one who isn't frozen becomes the next person who's it. A fun game. But you get to be frozen in time. You can't move. In our lives, there are moments that are kind of frozen in time for us. Memories. Moments that have a powerful impact on us. Locked in our brains, in our hearts, in our minds. Those special moments hold power and meaning for us. They can be both good or sometimes bad. It can be moments of profound joy or sadness and grief. For example, how many of you remember your first kiss? Or maybe the moment your bride said yes when you proposed, or when he said I do at the wedding. Maybe you remember the moment your child or children were each born. Or maybe a day you lost your job. How many of you remember the date 9/11? Do you remember where you were? Is that moment frozen in time for you? Yeah. I remember a phone call. I was touring with our son had gotten us. We wanted to go to Disney, so here, of course, you know, we're at Epcot Center, his favorite place, and we had a behind-the-scenes tour. We were going through the spaceship Earth, right? And all of a sudden, my cell phone rang, and I looked, and it was my brother. calling. My dad, our dad, we knew he wasn't well. That was the phone call that he had died. And you're in the happiest place on earth, right? Disney? And I had to tell our son, Grandpa's gone. I remember sitting on a bench quietly as we both just sat there, sad, grief. Those moments frozen in time, some joyous, some sad, filled with grief and sorrow. Those are defining moments often for us, aren't they? Defining moments that shape who we are. They make us know our story. They're part of our story. In our gospel reading today in Mark chapter 16, we have one of those defining moments. In fact, a series of very defining moments that these three women were part of. Their names were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome. Each had close connections with Jesus. Either he had healed them or that followed him, or they were parents of mothers of some of the disciples. They were part of Jesus' close inner circle. These women were with him through some of the most powerful moments of his ministry, both the highs and here we are at the lowest of lows. They were coming to the tomb because they had seen their Lord die, suffer and die on a cross. His body lay in that tomb all Sabbath long. They wanted to show some honor, some respect. They came early Sunday morning to anoint his body with spices, the least they could do for all the love that he had shown them. So they came to that tomb that moment. What were they expecting? Death. They weren't expecting life. They came expecting death. I wonder if we're any different than them. How would we have reacted that morning? We've heard the story, we've heard the promises, but you know what? So had they. Jesus had told them, he had warned them. He says, on the third day, the Son of Man will be raised from the dead. They should have known. Or to the thief on the cross, today you will be with me in paradise. Or Jesus taught them, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me will never die. Nevertheless, they came to the tomb expecting death. What was their conversation? Small talk. Who's going to remove the stone that covered the tomb? They came expecting death. When we come to our grave, what do we expect? Are we looking to that first Easter? Are we remembering what happened to Jesus? Are we coming to Easter hoping for that same promise? In the story then, the women were shocked and amazed when they finally got to the tomb and the stone was rolled away already. They peeked inside and there was a messenger, an angel or a young man dressed in white, it says, who spoke a message to them, said, do not be alarmed. Yeah, right. I think I'd be alarmed too. He said, you are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He died, right? But then the shock goes even deeper, that moment frozen in time where the angel says, he has been raised, he is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. Must have been hard to believe. Hard to know what to think. The shock that day. A moment etched in their memories forever. There's a beautiful story about a woman named Rosemary. She worked in an Alzheimer's unit in a nursing home. Rosemary and another colleague named Arlene brought the residents of the home together one Good Friday afternoon to view a movie. It was Franco Zeffirelli's acclaimed production of Jesus of Nazareth. They wondered whether these elderly Alzheimer's patients would even know what was going on, but they thought it might be worth the effort at least. They finally succeeded in getting everyone into position and they started the video. Rosemary was very pleasantly surprised at how quiet the residents were. They paid attention to the screen. They were glued to it. It was in the last scene in the movie where Mary Magdalene comes upon the empty tomb and sees Jesus' body is not there. An unknown man, in reality the risen Christ, asks Mary why she is looking for the living among the dead. Then Mary runs as fast as she can back to the disciples and tells Peter and the rest with breathless excitement, "He's alive. I saw him. I tell you, he is alive." But the doubt in their eyes caused Mary to pull back in the movie. She said, "You don't believe me, do you? You don't believe me." It was at that point in the Alzheimer's wing where someone in the crowd, one of the patients, voice sounded out. Her name was Esther. She said, "We believe you. We believe you. We believe. We come to Easter to have our hopes restored. To believe that Jesus rose from the dead. We don't come here necessarily to try to prove it. We can't prove it. We weren't there. But we can experience that resurrection." There were witnesses, yes. They were very passionate, like Mary and others. Many were martyred in defense of their deep conviction that it was true. But in reality, the best evidence we have for the resurrection is the transformation we see in people around us who know and believe in Jesus, how Jesus has changed them, transformed their lives, and is constantly transforming each of us into his image. Those defining moments happen. It happened for the women at the tomb, and it happens for us as well as we come to believe in Jesus. So then, back to that question, what is Easter for you? What does it mean for me? Is it a defining moment in your life? Or is it a moment happening again and again? An experience you came here to receive today. In our story, the angel speaks a little bit more and says something to the women that day. He goes on to say, "But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee, and there you will see him just as he told you." It's interesting. Think about that. He says, go and see. Go tell the disciples that you've seen him. But you notice there's something different. There's something special that maybe you crossed over a little too fast. There's someone included in there that was singled out. Someone by name was singled out. It says, go tell his disciples, and who? Peter. Why did the angel single Peter out in this story? Stop and think about what Peter had done. Peter had failed the Lord spectacularly. No one else had fallen as far short as he did. He had made grandiose promises, but fell short. This bold and brash Peter who tried to walk on water, the same one Jesus told him, "Get behind me, Satan." And no one felt worse than Peter. What had Peter done? That defining moment in his life he thought had ruined any chance he had. He denied the Lord three times. Not once, not twice, but three times when he promised he wouldn't. Was Peter going to be defined by that moment forever, having denied the Lord? Why did the angel single him out? I think for a reason. Not just for Peter, but for us, for you and me. A sign that Jesus wanted to see him, not to shame him, not to condemn him, but to forgive him. There was grace that was about to abound in the life of a sinner. His slate would be washed clean. Peter was singled out for grace and forgiveness, to be a target of God's love and mercy. Did he deserve it? No. Do we deserve it? No. Peter singled out for you and me today because we too have fallen short. We too have sinned. We have rejected the Lord. We have wandered away. But God's mercy is still there for you and me. He's calling us to come, to meet him. In a few moments, you will get a chance to meet him in a powerful way as well, as we are invited to the Lord's table to receive the holy sacrament of communion. It is in the breaking of the bread, eating and drinking, his words given and shed for you for the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection power taking place in your heart and in your life, a defining moment as you receive the holy sacrament. It can be for you a resurrection moment, right? Isn't that why we come to church each week? To be resurrected? What do we do the rest of the week? We keep sinning. We need it, don't we? And what does Jesus do in the lesson? It says he's going to go ahead of them and meet them in Galilee. Jesus goes ahead of us. He's already ahead of you today. He's ready for you. He knows what's on your heart. He knows what you need. And he's ready to lift you up like he did Peter. How does that make you feel? Glad. Let's stand right now. We're going to sing a song. I am so glad Jesus lifted me. I think the frozen chosen were moving a little bit there. Let's confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. May be seated. We have a special anthem, Because He Lives.
God sent his son. They called him Yeshua. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. God sent his son. They called him Yeshua. He came to love, heal and forgive. He bled and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. Because he lives.
Oh,
זה שהוא חי ממלא לי נחת זה שהוא חי מסיר אימה
I believe that was recorded about a year ago at the traditional site in Jerusalem of the tomb. And in the midst of all the chaos in Israel nowadays, you think about the challenges of doing something like that, but a powerful song. And so I'm glad you enjoyed that. A few announcements. First of all, welcome. Happy Easter. He is risen. Thank you all for joining us at First and Holy Cross Lutheran Churches. I'm Pastor Dan Baker and Pastor Michael Bresnan. Great to have you with us this Easter morn. And a lot of exciting things happening today. Welcome to everybody as well joining us on YouTube. It's great to have you with us. If you get a chance, don't forget to sign the guest book. Are there any guests among us? There are a couple people. Raise your hand. Don't be shy. Yeah, you're not alone. There's quite a few people, visitors, friends, family, all those kind of things. And so make sure you take time to visit and get to know and welcome each other and share in that resurrection hope. Plus, we have some treats afterwards, right? There is an Easter brunch. And, you know, a few weeks ago, yeah, I'm ready to clap too. I'm getting hungry. That thunder at the tomb was my stomach going, right? What I understood a few weeks ago was just a light snack of brunch became a smorgasbord, we would call it. So thank you to Patty and Bob and Cheryl and everybody in the committee. Scrambled eggs and ham, sausage gravy and biscuits, smoked salmon with bagel, French toast, pancakes, hash browns, fruit, desserts, and so on. Are you hungry? Well, we better get going with the service then so we can get to it. But yes, everyone is invited down that hall to the dining hall, and we'd love to have you all join us, as many as you can. And we'll be able to spread it out a little bit because there's an Easter egg hunt for the kids right afterwards. You heard me talking a little bit about with the kids. They got a bag, hopefully, or can get one in the back, and they're going to meet just right outside the front door here. And all of a sudden, when under direction, I think, was it Caitlin? Yeah, Caitlin is going to be leading the group right there and help them fairly get eggs and collect them in their baskets. Make sense? And no, there's not chocolate in them or to be melted by now already. But thank you to Caitlin and Bobby and Cadence for helping set that up, the Krause family's family as well. And so an Easter egg hunt right after church. So kids, hang out right back there. Be ready for that. Some of you can head on in and eat and begin the brunch. And then while the kids are having some fun here with the Easter egg hunt. Also a special thank you, the Easter Lilies. You see in the bulletin a wonderful list of those who helped donate to provide the lilies for us today. And so a thank you to those in memory or in honor of various people. And just thank you for doing that. You are welcome to take some home with you. In fact, if you didn't donate, there probably will be enough extras. You can grab one or two as well. So we don't want to be watering Easter lilies all week. We'd like you to take them with you today, if possible. So if you donated one, grab one. If you didn't, come and grab one too afterwards. So please don't be shy about grabbing a few lilies. Thank you to Ramila for getting them ordered and Bob and Patty for delivering them and getting them all set up. Also, in the back on the other side, the we have the Easter egg bags, but on the other side, I think we have a tub with bags for the homeless, where we're doing care bags, and they're collecting some of the reusable types, and we have a big plan. It's described in the bulletin how that works. Linda Harnish is putting that together, and going to need some people to assemble those bags. Wonderful way to help those out in need in the weeks coming, so keep that in mind. Also, just want to personally thank everybody that helped out with things during Holy Week, everything from the palms and the parade of Palm Sunday and the decorating, the Easter, the flowers, a lot of readers, even the readers this morning, and putting the music together, all those different things. Help lift our spirits and tell that story, those defining moments in our lives of faith. So thank you all for taking part in that. Pastor Breslin, do you have an announcement or two you'd like to share?
I have an announcement today, and it actually is a very important one. Those of you who came to the Good Friday Tenebrae service heard Jesus speak the words, "It is finished." What marvelous words those are when he spoke them, because they have dual meaning to us today. One, our sins are covered and gone. Amen. Secondly, Holy Cross's land is sold and closed. That means in the next week or two, we will be moving our office to First Facilities here.
Those are big things in the life of the church and defining moments as such, and so helping in the mission of the church. We'll continue now with our prayers, the prayers of the church. As you're able, I invite you to please stand or kneel. Let us pray for the whole people of God and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God, you kept your promise and delivered up your own Son to be our Savior. By his sacrificial death, our sins are forgiven. And by his rising again, we have the hope of everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us hold fast to the word preached to us, that receiving it with joy, we may take our stand in it and be saved by it. Hinder all who would sow doubt into our hearts. Grant us courage to confess its truth in our life and conversations. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Have mercy on the sick and those in need. We pray especially for those on our prayer list, for our missionaries, Anthony and Soyoung Solari, for healing for Cheryl, Logan, Ken, Lori, Mallory, Dolores, Patrick, Elizabeth, Nina, Dale, Cindy, Joan, Dennis. For all the members of Holy Cross and First Lutheran that are unable to be with Steve, Mike, Jill and family, Jackie, Memphis, and Patrick, and others we quietly name in our hearts. Let the dawning light of the new creation of Christ sustain them in faith. And according to your will, grant them renewed health, a foretaste of their eternal healing in him. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give us joy in your Son's great victory feast as he shares it with us from this altar. In the eating of his true body and drinking of his precious blood in faith, overcome our sin by his forgiveness and swallow up our death in his life, that we may be glad and rejoice in his salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We join today in singing eternal alleluias with innumerable angels in festal gathering, with the assembly of the firstborn enrolled in heaven, along with the spirits of the righteous made perfect. that we may bring these petitions before you, dear Father, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Now let us pause to confess our sins. Jesus, our host, we yearn for your communion. We yearn for the hope of new life. We yearn to meet you here. And yet, despite your invitation, we find ourselves stumbling on our way. Forgive us. Hear now, in silence, the confessions of your people. Please stand. And now hear the good news. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. In the name of the risen Christ, you are forgiven. In the name of the risen Christ, you are forgiven. Glory be to God.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and ever-living God. But chiefly we are bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of our Lord, for he is the true Passover Lamb who gave himself to take away our sin, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising has brought us to eternal life. And so with Mary Magdalene and Peter and all the witnesses of the resurrection, with earth and sea and all their creatures, with angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Do this in remembrance of me. Let us pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You may be seated as we invite our communion servers forward. You'll be directed down the center aisle for continuous communion. You will receive the bread, and then in the cups, there's in the center row, there is grape juice in place of wine if you prefer that. You'll be directed along down the side. You can drop off the cups on the end and return back to your seats. Come now, for the table is ready. Thank you.
Lord Jesus, the same day she was betrayed, took bread, when he gave thanks, he took it, blessed it, broke it, gave it to them and said, take, eat, this is my body, given for you.
Stand as you are able. And now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in his grace, his peace, his love, his joy, now and forever. Amen. Well, this is one of those defining moments where you run out of bread, and I don't know where the bread is kept. Now I know. So apologies for that, but I will not forget that. Let us continue with our resurrection litany. When others dismissed your story as an idle tale, who will you be?
Resurrection people with Easter
in our hearts. When the world seems to be crumbling around you, remember who you are. Resurrection people with Easter in our hearts. When despair would seem to squelch all hope, believe in who you have become. Resurrection people with Easter in our hearts. When it is hard to persevere against all odds, trust in God who names you. Resurrection people with Easter in our hearts. As we follow Christ into the world, may God help us remember who we are. Resurrection people with Easter in our hearts. May the loving power of God, which raised Jesus to new life, strengthen you in hope, enrich you in his love, and fill you with joy in the faith. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Sing our recessional hymn, Christ is Risen, Alleluia.
Oh! Thank you.
So sweet.